So, good afternoon and welcome back to the class on tribology after the internals. I have corrected like half of the students' papers and remaining students' marks will be returned back hopefully by today evening, right? So, basically before the internals, we were dealing about idealized full journal bearing. So, first we dealt about the journal bearing, hydrodynamic journal bearing, where we concentrated for heavy loaded condition. So we dealt about few derivations related to Petrov, Reynolds equation, Small number, all those steps. And then we started with idealized full journal bearing in the previous class. And there was a huge lot of derivation we had come across half the way. Right. Usually, they usually give you the derivation with respect to Petrov and the Reynolds number, and basically the problem do come in. But since the scheme has been changed, you have the derivation for idealized full journal bearing also. So it is like they might ask or may not, but still, as a part of a syllabus, we need to deal up. We had started this already in the last class, half the way. Since few were not there, I am just brushing out what we did basically. See, we have completed with hydrodynamic journal bearing, and then we started with idealized full journal bearing. When you call this as a full journal bearing, suppose if in a journal bearing you have a journal which rotates and the bearing head is fixed, then also it is a journal bearing, idealized case of full journal bearing. Or else you might have a journal which is a fixed member. So surrounding the fixed member, you might be having a machine member which will revolve around the journal. In that case also, it is called as full journal bearing. So this full journal bearing is basically used for lightly loaded condition. Hydrodynamic journal bearing, what we have completed basically, is for heavily loaded journal bearing. And this idealized case is usually focused for lightly loaded journal bearing. So you can get the numericals based on heavy loaded condition as well as a lightly loaded condition as well. So we discussed already, it is a huge lot of derivation what have done. I cannot go again step by step. Okay, so you people please refer for the link which has been shared for the last previous class recording. Here also in idealized full journal bearing, we followed the assumptions which was taken care with respect to Reynolds equation, and the terminologies also I explained with respect to the journal and the bearing, like where will be the eccentric ratio, the modulus of the journal bearing, the radius value for the bearing as well as for the journal, where will be H minimum and H maximum, the direction of the loaded condition, where will be P maximum, the pressure distribution will be maximum above and behind it will be the negative pressure distribution. So that also we dealt about. And we need to find basically an equation alternative for minimum clearance thickness. Okay, for that case we are using this idealized full journal bearing derivation. So we had done with all these. Okay, so where we analyzed, this is the ideal case. So when it has been stretched open at a particular condition, the journal surface, when it moves to the eccentricity position, so if that journal surface is unwrapped, it gets stretched into a straight line which usually have the length of 2 pi r. So where h will be the minimum thickness, all right, so between the journal and the bearing. So we need to find out the value of h, which will be equal to the value of k, where you have the pressure gradient to be the minimum, or to be the maximum also, we can evaluate the value of K. So that is the basic funda why we need to derive the equation for idealized full journal bearing. So this distance will be located across some specific position. So that is referred to be as our X. So with respect to this basic concepts, we had started with the derivation and we found out the equation for the film thickness H. And then we calculated the value for S, the specific value for the heat. And also we determined the values for the angle beta. So we had done until here. And then again, the minimum value of H with respect to eccentricity, when it is very small, we had dealt with this equation as well. So we were until here. So this equation we derived in the last class. So after that, you know that eccentricity ratio will be equal. N is the eccentricity ratio. So that will be equal to E upon C. So if you need the value of eccentricity, then you have to multiply N into C. So for this equation, what we have derived here in place of C, right? In place of E, we replace that into N into C. So this is another option to find out the minimum thickness of the film. So based on the data given, you can use this equation. So we have three equations for H. This is one equation. In general, in actual, with respect to the dimensions, you have one basic equation for film thickness. Then with respect to the eccentricity value, we have another equation for the film thickness. And if eccentricity ratio has been given, so this is the equation what we have to use. So we have derived the equation until here. After this, you have to consider, go back to the Reynolds equation what we have derived, right? So you just consider the Reynolds equation and write down what it is. And later we need to go for triangle 3. So in our diagram over here, right? So we have three triangles basically. So what we have studied, the first, the second, and the third triangle, right? Apart from that, now we have concluded with the minimum oil thickness equation. So now what is our next focus is to relate the value of H to K. For that, you should now try to figure out where the X is. So what is the X? I told you basically, X is the distance from which the minimum oil thickness is located. So it is lying between the stretch of E and H. So if you go back to the sketch here, so this is the journal surface and this is the bearing. So E, H is here. So this is B, this is H, and this is O1, right? So this is O. So this is the eccentricity value. If both becomes concentric, then both will be at this position. Okay, so E is exactly half the distance of BH. So if you consider this triangle, EO1 and H, the distance from here to here is our X, and this is our modulus value M. So don't consider this now. If you consider the triangle EO1 and H, this distance will give you, from E to H will give you the value of X. Some part of this distance will be our X in between E to H. So for that reason, we are taking this triangle E, H and O to evaluate the value of X. So in this acute angle triangle, if you consider that as our third triangle, okay, so from that, we can see that X will be equal to R into phi minus delta. So again, you have to go. R is nothing but the radius of the journal. So if you consider this E, O1 and H, this O1 to E will be nothing but the radius of the journal. So you have R into X, this distance. So what is the angle? The angle here total is beta. So when it comes here, you have this angle as delta, and this is delta, and again this is beta. So when you consider this triangle, if you join E, O1 and H, so then this will be an alternate angle for this. So if this is delta, this angle here also will be delta. And as a result, when you consider E, O1 and H, the value of X here will be equal to the radius of the journal into phi minus delta. So you will write it here as phi minus delta, but this delta value is assumed to be very small. So now the value of X gets reduced to R into phi. So now you have some key parameters associated with the value X. So this will be directly related to the radius of the journal and the inclination of the angle phi, right? So you cannot leave this as it is. We need to differentiate. So if you take dx is equal to r into d phi. So now you had dx before in the Reynolds equation. So in place of dx, we will try to replace that value by r into d phi. So this is the general Reynolds equation what we have derived earlier. So in this position of dx, you will write it as R into D phi. So the equation now changes to D upon R into D phi. This again remains same. H cube remains same. You will write dP upon, again in place of dx, you have to write R into D phi. So this 6 mu u remains the same. Again, dH upon dx. In place of dx, you will write here R D phi. Right? So after this, you slightly simplify. Okay, so once you write, so this is like the 1 by R will get removed in both the places. So it will be retained only with D upon D phi in within the bracket H cube into dP by D phi. So R is here. So you retain here. This R has been removed with this. So it will be retained with the value 6 mu u into dH by D phi. So after you get this equation, you will integrate with respect to phi. So when you integrate, a constant value also creep inside. So now after integration, you will be having, so first you write as H cube dP by R d phi. So this will be equal to 6 mu u H. After integrating, you will get a constant C1. So now the Reynolds equation slightly gets changed because you are differentiating now with respect to d phi and not dx. So this is the equation what we end up. But we need to find out a value for the constant. You cannot retain as it is. So what is the assumption we are taking? So we assume that R into C1 is equal to minus k, because we need the value of k. You need to compare the value of k with h. The k is a minimum thickness of the film when the pressure gradient is zero, or it could be the pressure gradient at height or the pressure gradient at minimum condition. To evaluate the pressure gradient at three different conditions, you need to know the value of k. And hence, to replace this constant, we are assuming that R into C1 is equal to minus K. So now what happens to the equation? So here you will assume R into C1 is equal to minus K. So here the equation will be this H cube we are taking here. So you here you will just write down dP by d phi. That will be equal to 6 mu u h r. This R will be remain as it is. But here you are taking C1 into R. Okay, because we are assuming C1 into R is equal to minus K. So in place of C1 into R, you will write the value as minus K. So this H cube from there you have taken over here. And since you are dividing, since you are adding C here to the numerator, since you are adding R here to the numerator, you have to write R in the denominator also. So that R will get cancelled with the R what you had previously in the numerator. I hope you're getting. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So that R will get cancelled with the denominator R, what we add on. So the equation now turns to be dP by d phi is equal to 6 mu u R H upon H cube minus K. So after this, you have to bifurcate. So you will simplify H upon H cube. So what happens here? H square will be retained. Similarly, you have to split up k upon h cube, and this 6 mu u r h upon h cube minus k upon h cube. So in this, h gets cancelled. So here denominator, it will be h square, but 6 mu u r you will take outside the bracket. So this will be the equation what we slightly reduce. Then you have to take d phi towards our right hand side. So dP will be equal to 6 mu u r into 1 by h square minus k by h cube into d phi. So we end up with an equation where we are relating the pressure gradient value, right? So once you end up with the value of dP, go back to the previous equation where we had the minimum oil thickness film thickness equation. So that is h is equal to c into 1 plus n cos phi. Right, we had this equation before. Right, h is equal to c plus nc cos phi. Here c is taken as a common factor. So if you take c as common factor, then it will become 1 plus n into cos phi. So same equation now is being used over here. So h is equal to c into 1 plus n cos phi. So now you know the value of H. So after this, you will write down the value for DP. So what is the value for DP? You will, this is 6 mu UR into 1 by H square minus K by H cube into D phi. But you know the value of H. The value of H is C into 1 plus L cos phi. So now you have to substitute the value of H for both the denominators. So the equation now gets changed. DP remains the same. 6 mu UR remains the same. Numerator 1 remains the same. In place of H square, you will be writing C square into 1 plus N cos phi the whole square. Again, minus K remains the same. In place of H cube, you will be writing C cube into 1 plus N cos phi whole cube. And D phi, again, you will write it as it is. Okay, so after this, again, you can observe the C value is also common in both the side. Here you have C square and here you have C cube. At least you can remove C square outside. So now you reduce the equation DP is equal to 6 mu UR upon C square. So then the remaining part you will write. So it is 1 upon C square is removed. So the denominator here will be 1 plus N cos phi whole square minus K upon the denominator here, C cube, C square is removed. So 1 C will be retained. C into 1 plus N cos phi whole cube into D phi. So this will be the equation what we end up for the pressure gradient. So once you get this equation, you have to integrate the above equation to 0 to 2 pi, right? Because you will be having the rotation of the journal with respect to 0 to 360 degree based on the direction in which it is moving, right? So you need to integrate the value of pressure between 0 to 2 pi. So right, so this equation you will integrate from 0 to 2 pi for what condition? When the pressure gradient is 0. So the pressure gradient could be 0, the pressure gradient could be maximum, and the pressure gradient could be minimum. So now we are focusing for the condition where the pressure gradient is 0. For that purpose, you have to integrate the equation from 0 to 2 pi. So this is the condition. So wherein you integrate the previous equation, what we have got with respect to 0 to 2 pi. So when the pressure gradient value is 0, so then you can equate these equation towards left hand side and right hand side. So that I will tell you next. Since it is assumed now the pressure gradient to be 0, you are integrating from 0 to 2 pi. And hence you will write the previous equation as it is with the integration 0 to 2 pi. And instead of writing dp, you will write it as is equal to 0 because we are assuming the pressure gradient to be 0. So the equation now will be equal to 0. And you know that the altitude or the eccentricity ratio is always a reciprocal of 1 upon n. So this has also been mentioned in the design handbook at page number 4. So due to this, now we can slightly change the equation, right? So n is equal to 1 upon alpha. So the altitude value will be the reciprocal of the eccentric ratio. So that is nothing but alpha is equal to 1 upon n. But the eccentricity value, eccentricity ratio is also equal to E upon the radial clearance, right? So from these two, what you can understand is n is equal to E upon C, and that is also equal to 1 upon alpha. So directly we can tell that altitude will be the reciprocal of the eccentricity ratio. So we have in the equation here 1 upon n. So in place of that, now we can replace the value with respect to the altitude, which is nothing but alpha. So before doing that, we have to get the ratio for K by C. So K will give you the diametrical clearance, and the C will give you the diametrical clearance, and K will give you the thickness of the film of the oil at pressure equal to zero, or at pressure equal to maximum, or pressure distribution equal to minimum. So first, before applying the value of altitude, try to get the ratio for K by C. So if you want to get the ratio for K by C, instead of writing the equation as shown over here is equal to zero, you have to distribute the terms towards left hand side and right hand side. So you can write this part is equal to K by C into this part instead of equating to zero. And hence the equation comes in this way. So the left hand side will be equal to the right hand side if we omit the value equal to zero. So after writing in this way, you now simplify the equation to identify the ratio of the minimum oil thickness film at pressure gradient equal to zero upon the diametrical clearance. So when you take K by C here, you will get the integration of this part at the numerator and the integral part of this in the denominator. So in both the case, 1 by n square is common. We are taking this 1 by n square back outside because we need to represent that into the altitude value. So you have to figure out how you will remove 1 by n. So you will take 1, this is whole square. So if you take n outside the integral, so it will be 1 upon n square. So you will take the integral of 0 to 2 pi. Okay, so this will be equal to d phi. It was n here. If you're taking 1 by n, so in this place of 1, you have to write it as 1 upon n, right? So 1 upon n. Here you won't write n because this n with this n square gets cancelled. So you will be retained with 1 upon n plus cos phi whole square. Similarly, in the denominator, you're taking 1 by n as a common factor outside, right? So if you take this outside, so you'll be retained here with, instead of 1, 1 upon n plus cos phi. This n will get cancelled with n square. So whole cube remain as it is. So now you have changed the equation of a Reynolds equation in terms of K by C, which provides you the minimum thickness of the oil film when the pressure gradient is zero with respect to the diametrical clearance of the bearing. Okay, so now you have ended up with respect to the terminologies where you can see 1 by n easily in the numerator and denominator. So now we can replace this 1 by n with respect to the altitude value or the eccentricity value. So this equation holds good when we assume that the eccentricity is 0, means both are concentrating at a common point where E is 0. E is 0 means this basic difference, the difference between O1 and O, both will be concentric and this distance will not be there at all. The journal center and the bearing center will be exactly at one common point where E will be equal to zero. In that case only you can equate and figure out the value of K by C. Okay, so this will be the equation. Now, as I told that, 1 by n will be equal to the value of the altitude or the eccentricity. Now we easily replace 1 upon n by our alpha. So the equation is changed with alpha square. Wherever we had 1 by n, it is changed into alpha square. So it gets simplified from this form to this. Here you had 1 by n square and 1 by n square. This gets cancelled. So no need of substituting the value of alpha over here. So you'll be just be retained with these two values in the numerator and denominator. So you will substitute the value of alpha in both the cases and simplify for some part. So then it gets reduced in this way. Okay. So after this, what you do is, you need to find out only the value of K, because our main goal of deriving the equation for idealized full journal bearing is to find out the minimum thickness of the oil film when the pressure gradient is zero. Since it is associated with the diametrical clearance here, just try to shift the value of C towards the other end. So K will be equal to 2C into, this part is again simplified. After simplification, it will be into alpha square minus 1 upon 2 alpha square plus 1. So this is an equation which gets ended up with the value of K. So now we have the thickness of the oil film, right, for the pressure gradient to be equal to zero in terms of altitude value and the diametrical clearance. So after this, again, what we follow is we tell again the altitude is equal to 1 upon n. So now you will change the same terminology with respect to the eccentricity ratio. So the value of K here we got with respect to the altitude or the eccentricity. So now we will change the value of the K with respect to eccentricity ratio. So the now equation changes to 2C into, but first we will substitute here. Alpha square means it is 1 by n my whole square minus 1 upon 2 into 1 by n whole square plus 1. Then you have to take the LCM for the numerator and denominator, and then you will simplify. After simplification, you will get K is equal to 2C into 1 minus n square upon 2 plus n square. So this is the equation for the minimum thickness of the oil film when the pressure gradient is zero. But if you want to know the physical meaning of the value K, you have to go back to the pressure gradient equation, right? So here we know that dp by d phi is equal to 6 mu ur into 1 by h square minus k by h cube. So this equation we had been derived a little few minutes before. Right, so here we had this equation dp by d phi is equal to 6 mu ur into 1 by h square minus k by h cube. So this was the pressure gradient equation before we made any changes with respect to the eccentricity ratio, right? So this general equation we are writing back over here again to relate the value of h and k. So we wrote this, but here we are focusing only on what condition? The pressure gradient is equal to zero. But this could be solved even when the pressure gradient value is maximum and when the pressure gradient value is minimum. For that, you have to provide the range of integration. If the pressure gradient is maximum, so you know that where the pressure distribution will be maximum and where the pressure distribution will be minimum, right? So you'll be having the two parts basically. So we'll be having the pressure gradient here above and the pressure gradient below. So the pressure distribution below will be a negative magnitude one, and this will be the positive magnitude one. So you will show the distribution of the pressure over here, which will be maximum and minimum. So you will be having the inclination of the angle where it will be minimum and where it will be maximum. So all those angles to be given exactly to derive the equation for when the pressure distribution will be maximum and minimum. But here we are focusing only when the pressure gradient value is equal to zero. So in this case, what we do is, in place of dp by d phi, you will type it as zero. So zero will be equal to the same thing, 6 mu ur, open the bracket, 1 upon h square minus k upon h cube. So this is the equation what we get. Right. So after this, you will just omit this constant value. So it will be directly 0 is equal to 1 upon h square minus k upon h cube, because you don't have any pressure gradient, no pressure at all. Right. So and as this is the equation what you come into picture, then you simplify and you say that the value of h will be equal to value of k when the pressure gradient value is equal to zero. So this is what we were supposed to conclude in case of idealized full journal bearing. Okay, so if they ask you to derive an equation for idealized full journal bearing to show that the thickness of the oil film is equal to the value of h across dp by d phi is equal to zero, so you need to end up with this equation. So even though in the problem, if they give you the value of K or if they give you the value of H, this is a general equation what we use with respect to eccentricity ratio. If it is altitude, then the equation changes. If it is eccentricity ratio, the equation changes. If they ask you to find out the value of K for idealized full journal bearing, it is nothing but the thickness of the oil film, the minimum thickness of the oil film across which the pressure gradient is zero. So at that time, you should not think they haven't given the value of altitude or you don't know the value of H. How will you find out K? All those questions should not come. Both H and K will be equal at pressure gradient equal to zero in case of idealized full journal bearing. An idealized full journal bearing we do use for lightly loaded conditions. So whenever you get a problem to solve on lightly loaded condition, then it is an full journal bearing. In that case, if it is mentioned as pressure gradient is equal to zero, you need to find out the value of K, which will be equal to the value of H at this particular condition. Apart from that, outside the syllabus, if you want to still know the value of K for the pressure gradient to be maximum and pressure gradient to be minimum, you can use the same concept of this equation. Just integrate with respect to the range of the angle when it is maximum and when it is minimum, you will get the values of H and K. But that is not there in your syllabus, but as a part of completion of idealized full journal bearing, you can do it for all the three cases when the pressure gradient is zero, when it is maximum and when it is minimum. So this is about idealized full journal bearing. Hope this is clear until now. Any doubts associated with this? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Any doubts? So after that, from the next class, we'll be solving with the numericals. Please be regular or else you will find it difficult. We have come across the terminologies of hydrodynamic journal bearing, but still all the things I'm mentioning here, because it should help you for your solving the exam problems in the exam as well as in the internals. So whenever it is a diametrical clearance, you should know that it is represented by C. And it gives you the difference basically between the diameter of the bearing and the diameter of the journal. So mathematically, you represent C is equal to capital D minus small d. Small d always provides the diameter of the journal, not the bearing. Don't get confused. Capital D is the diameter of the bearing. And suppose if they tell you the radial clearance, it is not just C, it will be C1. And the value for that will be different. Radial clearance will be exactly equal to half of your diametrical clearance. You know that radius is always equal to half the diameter. Same concept here. If they have given you the diametrical clearance, if you need the radial clearance, don't take the value directly. You have to divide that by 2. So C1 will be equal to C upon 2. So this is about the radial clearance value, what you have to know. Then, if you need the diametrical clearance ratio, okay, so then what you have to do is, it is capital D minus D as you did for diametrical clearance, but that has to be divided by small d. So the diametrical clearance ratio is nothing but the ratio of the diametrical clearance upon the diameter of the journal. Right? So this C, you know, it is nothing but capital D minus D. So you can substitute capital D minus D upon D. Sometimes what happens, they can give you the value of diametrical clearance directly. If that is not given, the diameter of the journal, the diameter of the bearing and the diameter of the journal will be given. So you have to subtract and get the value of C and then divide by D, which is the diameter of the bearing, journal. Then you should determine the diametrical clearance ratio. So you should be knowing the terminologies and the equation and the parameters with respect to the data given in the problem. Then only you will be able to solve it. And later on, eccentricity, right? So I told you it is nothing but the distance between the center of the bearing to that of the center in which it has been displayed. It is a radial distance between the center of the bearing and the displayed center. O to O dash is our value of eccentricity. And eccentricity is always represented by E. Sometimes the student get confused with eccentricity and eccentricity ratio. both are different. Eccentricity value is different and eccentricity ratio is different. So kindly be careful. Then you need to know what is minimum oil film thickness, which is nothing but our H naught. See, you'll be having the film thickness, you'll be having maximum film thickness, you'll be having the minimum film thickness. So minimum film thickness is represented by H naught. Okay, so you should be able to determine what is the value of minimum value of film thickness. So that is represented by H naught. Okay, so if you consider here, so here also you have value of H. So this is a maximum film thickness. But if you come here down below the journal, so this is the H naught, which will be the minimum thickness of the oil film. So this distance will be measured as H naught value. So this we have dealt already, but still I am brushing out the terminology so that you won't get confused enough. And this value of H naught, you can cross check whether you have done proper or not. It is always assumed to be the value of C divided by 4. What is C? Anyone can tell me? What is the value of C? Hello? What is the value of C? You people have to answer. What is the value of C? Are you people there? So what we were discussing from so long time, what is the value of C here? You should speak. C is nothing but the diametral clearance, what we have discussed already. So diametrical clearance upon 4 will be the assumed value for the minimum thickness of the oil, which is denoted by H naught. So you can cross check after evaluating the value of H naught, is it almost near to the value of C by 4. Then you should measure what is attitude or eccentricity ratio, right? The eccentricity ratio is always given by eccentricity upon the radial clearance. For radial clearance, we never write as C, it will be always C1. So altitude or the eccentricity ratio could be represented by alpha or permittivity symbol, which will provide you the attitude value. Okay, so this is the equation what we follow, E upon C1. And after this, you should be knowing some terminologies like short bearing and long bearing. So what is short and long bearing? If the ratio of the length of the diameter of the journal is less than 1. See, you'll be having the diameter of the journal and diameter of the bearing. If the diameter of the journal, when you measure, if it is less than 1, then you call that as a short bearing. Okay? And if L by D is greater than 1, then you call that as a long bearing. So L will be the length of the shaft and small d will be the diameter of the journal. So if the ratio of L by D is greater than 1, then you call that to be as the long bearing. So by seeing the values, you should be able to tell whether it is a short bearing or a long bearing. So L by D less than 1 is short bearing. L by D ratio greater than 1 is associated with the long bearing. So you should be knowing this. And some terminologies, you should be able to figure out the equation for coefficient of friction. So you know that in case of journal bearing, the coefficient of friction is given by mu is equal to phi into Zn by P, D by C and L by D. So you'll be having three parts over here, right? Where Zn by P is nothing but the bearing characteristic number. And always remember, it is a dimensionless number, right? So you should remember not to assign any units to it. It is a dimensionless number which will provide you the bearing characteristic number. So in that, you have three parameters, Zn upon P, where Z will be the absolute viscosity of the lubricant. So Z will provide you what is the viscosity, absolute viscosity of the lubricant. We have studied what is viscosity, how the distribution of the viscosity is in the lubricant film, right? The absolute value, everything. So here Z will stand for absolute viscosity of the lubricant and its units. And similarly, N will provide you what is the speed with which the journal is rotating in terms of its RPM. And P will speak about purely the bearing pressure which has been projected in that particular area which is in contact. Okay, so this will be represented in terms of Newton per mm square. So how the bearing pressure will be evaluated? It is done by seeing what is the load which is on the journal divided by the product of L into D. So L will be the length of the shaft and D will be the diameter of the journal. So this will provide you the bearing pressure value. So this is one unit in the coefficient of friction. So then you have D upon C. So what is D? D is the diameter of the journal. And what is C? C is the diametrical clearance. If you put C1 here, C suffix 1, then it becomes radial clearance. So be careful while writing, see that whether it is C or C suffix 1. And then you have L by D. So L will be the length of the bearing and D will be the diameter of the journal. So this is how the parameters will be associated in evaluating the coefficient of friction for any given journal bearing. Okay, so it could be an hydrostatic journal bearing for heavy loaded condition, or it could be an idealized journal bearing for lightly loaded condition. So these are the key parameters what you have to be aware enough. And then sometimes you should be knowing the value of bearing modulus for any journal bearing associated with. So here, we usually plot the graph with respect to coefficient of friction along y-axis, and we'll be having the number, which is the bearing characteristics number, along the x-axis. So this is what we basically deal up when it comes for the bearing characteristics number. So now you have to look on the graph. How does it? Yeah, I'm sorry, there was an emergency in between. So back to our diagram, we were dealing with respect to the graph related to the coefficient of friction with the, and our dimensionless number along the y-axis, which is nothing but the bearing characteristics number. So you can see how the variation of coefficient of friction has been taking. So here you can observe, so as the bearing characteristics number is increasing in the x-axis, and how the variation in the coefficient of friction comes. So here the coefficient of friction graph, what we are getting is higher in the beginning, it is reduced at the in between, and again it is going at a higher rate. So you have to bifurcate the nature of the graph, what we are getting for coefficient of friction, into three parts. So here we can observe that we have three sections. One is the thin film, the other one is the thick film lubrication, and this is the partial lubrication. So if you divide the graph here into three parts, so from S to R, it will be thin film. And from R to Q, it will be partial lubrication. And from Q to P, it will be thick film lubrication. And we have studied the difference between thick film lubrication and thin film lubrication also. When the surface in between the journal and the bearing will be stable, and when the surface between the journal and the bearing will be unstable. So it is with respect to thin film as well as a thick film lubrication. Apart from these two sections, we have one more part in between R and Q. Here it is neither thin film lubricated or it is neither thick film lubricated. It is partially lubricated. So with respect to the layer of lubrication, you can observe how the coefficient of friction is increasing. So when you had a very thin film of lubrication, the coefficient friction value was the highest, right? So as the thin film lubrication reduced and came into partial, almost the coefficient of friction was least. And when the thickness of the film increased and it was stable, and again the coefficient of friction started increasing drastically. So this is the graph plotted with respect to the bearing characteristics number. So bearing characteristics number is provided by Zn by P. After you draw the graph, if you just draw an intercept to your y-axis, that will provide you what is the minimum coefficient of friction value at this particular point A. Okay, so similarly, if you draw an intercept here along x-axis, it will provide the value of the minimum bearing characteristics number across the minimum coefficient of friction. So these two will be the feasible values of coefficient of friction and the bearing characteristics number, so that the bearing can run smoothly with reduced amount of friction and wear. So this is how you have to analyze. Once you get the data from the once you get the specification detail from the journal bearing, from where you have opted, so you can see the range of coefficient of friction value with respect to the bearing characteristics number, how it varies depending upon which grade of lubrication you are using. So from that you can select which is the grade of lubrication feasible enough to run the journal bearing with least coefficient of friction, so that you can rely on this journal bearing for the longer run. If you are able to categorize the values in this way, so then you can run the journal bearing either for heavy loaded or lightly loaded condition in a safer zone with least amount of coefficient of friction. Okay, so this value K will provide you the minimum thickness of the oil film which is needed, okay, to run the journal bearing with zero pressure gradient. Okay, so this value of K also will help you to sketch out the value of K what we have derived here, where the pressure gradient is equal to zero. So this is how you have to correlate the concepts and the terminologies, which helps you to solve the problems easily, right? So after this, we dealt with the coefficient of friction in general, which has been used in journal bearing. And also there is one more coefficient of friction by chance. If in the question they gave you, which has been originated by McKee. Okay, so these were the person who derived the coefficient of friction based on bearing characteristics number. So the bearing characteristics number was also being obtained by McKee brothers. The same McKee brothers evaluated the coefficient of friction equation also in a different way, right? So here mu is equal to 33 upon 10 to the power of 8 into Zn by P into D by C plus K. So here the same thing, what is Znp, I have explained, everything is same, only the numerical parameter here has been changed. And here, and the value of K is slightly changed. So K will be the factor to correct the end leakage. Always in any case of journal bearing, there will be end leakage. We just consider one directional flow. If we consider two directional flow in deriving the equation for Petrov or Reynolds, then the equation will get slightly changed. But we have followed one assumption in deriving the Reynolds equation, only assuming the flow in one direction. If we consider the leakages, the other direction flow also comes into picture. But McKee brothers, while evaluating the coefficient of friction, they have considered the end leakage factor also and the correctness factor to that leakage. So that is usually dependable on the ratio of length to the diameter of the bearing. So it is given by L upon D. So K value here will be given upon L upon D. Usually it will be there in the range of 0.75 to 2.8. So this is the equation for coefficient of friction, which is there derived by McKee brothers, which took the factor of end leakage also. So it depends upon the data which has been given. So based on that, you have to opt the equation what you use for coefficient of friction. I'm providing you all the supporting data so that you won't lose marks if something extra data has been given in the question related to the end leakage. So to be on safer side, I'm covering all the aspects of it. Even that long derivation, it can come or may not. But if it comes, you should be able to solve. For that, we should cover everything which is there in the syllabus. And hence, I'm covering each and every part. Apart from that, we have derived the Petrov equation, right? As per Petrov law, this is an equation for coefficient of friction, which comes into picture, right? This Petrov and Mackey equations, what I'm telling you, are basically employed only for lightly loaded bearings. So lightly loaded bearings comes into picture only in case of idealized full journal bearing. Why? Because in idealized full journal bearing, you will be having the bearing head fixed and the journal will be rotating. Or else the second option, when the journal will be fixed and you'll be having another machine member which revolves around it. In that case also, we call it as full journal bearing. In both the case, you cannot apply the load at a higher range. So it will be feasible only to work in lightly loaded bearing condition. And hence, if they provide you the value of coefficient of friction with respect to Mackey brothers, yeah, Petrov, it is always understood that it is a problem on lightly loaded bearing. So these are the key points what you have to understand. And then this Sommerfeld number. So this we have derived related to our Petrov equation also. The same thing has been rewritten here. And basically for the design purpose, the value of Zn upon P into D by D squared whole square will be figured out to a numerical value of 14.3 into 10 raised to the power of 6. So this is about the Sommerfeld number and this numerical value what we usually consider in case of designing a journal bearing. Okay, so later we were speaking about the pressure distribution. It could be null, it could be maximum, yeah, medium. In all the three cases, you should be knowing what is the critical pressure or the minimum operating pressure which is coming across in the journal bearing when it is rotating. So for that, this is the equation we do follow. So it will be Zn upon 4.75 into 10 raised to 6 into D by C whole square into 1 upon D plus L, right? Newton per mm square. So this is the equation what we will be using to determine the critical pressure. Apart from that, it is not necessary that always they do ask the heat generated or dissipated in journal bearing. By chance, if they ask you, you should be knowing the equation what you have to use. So if heat generated in the journal bearing is being asked, this is the equation what you follow. Q suffix G. G here, Q refers for the heat generation. Q refers for the heat. And if you write specific word called G here, Q suffix G, then it is heat generated. If it is Q suffix D, it is a dissipated heat. So for heat generated equation, we have the equation mu into W into V. So the unit for heat generated could be in Newton meter per second, or it could be in joules per second, or it could be in watts. So where you will be knowing the coefficient of friction, what you have derived. You'll be knowing what is the load which has been subjected into the bearing in terms of N. And you'll be knowing the rubbing velocity, which is in unit meter per second, which is nothing but pi dN by 60, wherein you have to take D in meters only. And N will be the speed with which the journal is rotating. So all the data you'll be knowing. Only thing you have to substitute to the equation and calculate what is the heat generated in the given journal bearing. Similarly, you should be able to figure out for heat dissipated. So here heat dissipated will be given by Q suffix D is equal to C into A, open the bracket, T suffix B minus T suffix A. So this will be measured in terms of joules per second or watts, similar to that of heat generation. So here the value of C will be heat dissipation coefficient. A will be the projected area of the bearing. So what is the projected area of the bearing in which the journal is in contact at the loading condition? And T suffix B will be the temperature of the bearing surface and T suffix A will be the temperature of the surrounding air, because you'll be having the bearing and the journal in between. You'll be having the clearance, which will be filled by the lubricant film, which is surrounded by the air. So that will be the temperature T suffix A, what you have to know. So once you know all this data, you can determine the heat dissipated value. So this is what you have to know finally. And lastly, if it is asked what is the mass of the lubricating oil required for artificial cooling, when it is heated, you need some media to cool it, right? So in that case, you need something called as artificial cooling. So where you apply a layer of oil to remove the amount of heat generated. So this is one concept you should be knowing. So once after this, from next class, I will just speak about the load bearing capacity in the next class. So for this also, actually there is a derivation, but it has not been asked in the examination. I will explain you the diagram in detail, why the load carrying capacity is needed, and then we'll go for solving the problems. So any doubt until here? Hope this is clear. Any doubt, kindly let me know. Any doubts?
No, ma'am.
All are clear. I'll come to know how much it is clear when we solve the problem. At that time, the problems comes into mind. What is that? What is this? So always you should listen carefully and note down the key points so that it will be helpful for you to solve the problem. So today's every equation, what I have explained you, when and how to use for lightly loaded condition and heavy loaded condition, you should be careful to select the equation and calculate the data. Sometimes they can ask you to draw the graph and show the pressure distribution, or sometimes they can ask you to determine the coefficient of friction, the other terminologies of the journal bearing. So you should read the question and understand for which is the problem asked. Is it for lightly loaded? Yeah, for heavily loaded. Then you have to proceed. If you go blindly, then you might end up with a wrong answer. So be careful, understand the concept, brush out each and every concept before coming to the next class so that we can start solving the problems. So I just take the attendance, 2 seconds. At the same time, everyone type your name and URL in the chat room. Abdul Khaliq Pasha.
Ma'am, present, ma'am. Hello.
Yeah. Okay. Akhil KB.
Yes, ma'am.
Anil Kumar.
Present, ma'am.
Ankesh Aman.
Yes, ma'am.
Gautam Krishna, I think he is absent. Balaji VR.
Yes, ma'am. Present, ma'am.
Beldar Mohammed. Even though you're writing in the chat room, don't leave the classroom without answering the attendance. Belda Mohammed. Chaitanya SR.
Present, ma'am.
Yeah, you have explained well in the internals. Keep it up. Chetan Kumar.
Present, ma'am.
Dheeraj.
Present, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Ishant.
Yes, ma'am.
For the first time, Ishant is answering. Hope your mic is proper now.
Yes, ma'am.
Harshita.
Yes, ma'am.
Himanka.
Yes, ma'am.
Kanishka.
Yes, ma'am.
Kanishka, kindly improve your handwriting. It was very difficult for me to read.
Okay.
Just an humble request. Nagamurli Krishna. Absent. Kunal Raj.
Present, ma'am.
Danush. Mohammad Ayan.
Yes, ma'am.
Mohammad Junaid.
Yes, ma'am.
Shri Prasad is absent. Niharika.
Yes, ma'am.
Nihar Venkat Sai.
Yes, ma'am.
Nikhil R.
Yes, ma'am.
Nirav.
Yes, ma'am.
Prajwal S. Bhatt.
Present, ma'am.
Rishabh Pandey.
Present, ma'am.
Rohan Kaglakar. Rohan. Absent. Roshan Yadav. Okay. Suman Sagar.
Yes, ma'am.
Sagar Dutt Mathur. Sagar. Absent. Sagar GV.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Sanjay Raghav.
Yeah, ma'am.
Shobit. Shobit, I think, is absent. Siddharth. Siddharth B. Siddharth Sridhar. Both the Siddharth are absent today. Subramanya.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Tirumanu Seti Rohan.
Yes, ma'am.
Ulas. Ulas, you're there? Absent. Vidyan.
Present, ma'am.
Varun.
Present, ma'am.
Pawan. Pawan is on. Danush.
Ma'am, Pawan present, ma'am.
Pawan present. Why did you not answer them? Danush. Danush. Absent. Dhyanesh Kumar.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Gunasagar.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Meghanatha Prasad. Meghanatha Prasad. Rasik Baran.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Shiv Krishna.
Yes, ma'am.
Shreyas. Shreyas. Srinivasalu. Absent. Yogananda.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. Kiran R. Mr. Kiran. He is absent continuously for the fifth class. Someone inform him to call me. Ranveer Singh Chauhan.
Present, ma'am.
Ranveer, why you were absent for such a long time? It is only 8 classes you have attended out of 25. What is the reason?
Ma'am, I was suffering from corona.
You were suffering from corona. How are you now?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I am fine now. That's why.
Okay. Kindly see that you can extract the material from Google Classroom as well as YouTube channel. If any doubts, please free to call me at any time. Okay?
Yes, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
Yeah, thank yeah. You. Gautam Sai?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Shiv Pawan? Shiv Pawan? Okay. Alok? Alok M. Fine. So everyone take care. Have a nice day. I will be sharing some quiz link shortly. And some of you have not submitted the sim lab record for remaining programs. It has been posted in the Google Classroom long back. Now the internals are over. Kindly see that before Thursday class you do complete. I'm telling you this for B1 batch students. So kindly complete those who haven't uploaded yet the second part of your record writing. First, everyone have done it. So I think 3 programs, what is it been left out? You have to submit at the earliest. I need all the records for the correction before Thursday class. Until then, take care and have a nice day. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye-bye-bye.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah. Ishan.
Ma'am, few of us wrote the 5th and 8th experiment before only and submitted in the first assignment itself. So do we have to?
Okay. No. Please don't add again. If you have written already, kindly don't add on. Only the pending programs you do complete. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
I think only program 7 will be left out for you guys then.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So just upload that. That is more than enough. Just you put a private message saying that the remaining thing is submitted already in the first assignment.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, then. Yeah. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you.